Walk down Vancouver's Robson Street these days and you'll see store after store papered over. The businesses that used to occupy the spaces are empty. The shops have for lease signs on them. Those businesses shut down because the cost of rent has skyrocketed in harmony with the skyrocketing value and subsequent skyrocketing property taxes of commercial real estate, a market that was ignited when the provincial government introduced the foreign buyer's tax on residential properties. To people looking to invest in Vancouver real estate, the go-home tax didn't make them walk away from owning land in Greater Vancouver. They merely shifted their focus. They were able to do this because the province publicity-infused vote-getting campaign designed to cool the housing market didn't include a stay-out-of-BC clause on commercial real estate. There are no school taxes, no empty home taxes, no foreign owner taxes on commercial and industrial real estate. And human beings, being human beings, did what they always do. They simply adapted to government policies and found ways around the rules in an effort to meet their own needs. In doing so, they're driving up commercial property values, which in turn drive up rental rates and property taxes. Tenants are not only seeing rising rental rates, they're also responsible to pay the increased property taxes, which in turn are driving many independent businesses out of business. The only companies that can afford the rent are national and international chains, which charge more for their goods in Vancouver than in any other North American city. Along the way, the very soul of Vancouver's retail market is disappearing along with thousands of jobs. We invited Andrey Pavlov, a finance professor at the Beedie School of Business, to join us for a conversation that matters about the unintended consequences of a tax that forgot to look at the downstream effect it would create.
Conversations That Matter is a partner program for the Center for Dialogue at Simon Fraser University. The production of this program is made possible thanks to the support of the following and viewers like you.
Welcome.
Thank you.
We're living in an incredibly interesting real estate market, and everybody's looking at the cost of housing. But that same hot real estate market is also shifting towards a hot commercial market as well. Mm-hmm. Why? Where has the interest in the commercial side come from, especially as we're seeing things drop off on the real estate or home market side?
Right. Well, there is clear link between residential and commercial, and the link is through land. So mm-hmm. when land values go up because it's profitable to build condos, you know, that land that probably would have been available for commercial is no longer available for commercial. It's going to be built in residential. So then there's less land. So then there's less supply of commercial as well. So there's that clear channel. But otherwise, other than that, that's not enough, right? That's not enough to have higher prices. What you also need is demand.
Yes.
I mean, our economy is not particularly strong, but it's growing. There's unemployment is low. You know, the global economy is growing, and therefore, you know, there will be some growth here. At least that's what people expect. So rents are high, commercial rents are high, and then there's now interest in buying commercial property. The other link is if you're a foreign investor and you were thinking about buying a home, well, with the 15 and now 20% foreign buyer tax, you might consider you know, buying a commercial property. It sort of gives you the same exposure to the land, which is really the valuable commodity here, in Vancouver at least, but you don't pay the tax, and the rents are not bad. So the return you get, I mean, it's much lower than anywhere else in North America, but still it's mm-hmm. respectable.
Right, and so this is one of the things. It's some of that money that was going into the residential market from foreign buyers has now shifted towards commercial properties.
That's right, and it makes sense if you want to have exposure to the Vancouver real estate market, but you don't actually want to live here, mm-hmm. right? It would be easier to manage, to invest in a commercial property and lease that long term for an office building or a retail store or whatever the property is. Sort of like that's more like an investment, and you still get the uplift of any land value appreciation that presumably you expect if you want to buy here.
But that's putting pressure on that market, and ultimately it starts to put pressure on the rental market. And it's now starting to put pressure on businesses that are operating in those commercial properties.
And obviously that's going to drive away businesses. I remember a few years back I did a number of interviews on the closure of the railroad club.
Yes.
Because I liked it and I used to go there and it was awesome, right? And it closed. And the single reason the owners identified was, we can't really keep going in this sort of rents. And that is happening across town.
Yes.
Now, having said that, there are other businesses that are coming in. The problem is that the businesses that tend to come in are higher value added businesses. In other words, they have to charge a lot their customers in order to pay the high rent. And interestingly, the relatively high commercial property taxes. So recently I was surprised to find out that Vancouver has very high commercial property taxes relative to residential. And even for a small store, those taxes add up quite fast. And of course, government is the first claim on that.
So, yes.
So that doesn't help either.
Right. Right?
So between rising property, land values, making property values higher, commercial property values higher, and then that forces rents higher, and higher property taxes, it's hard to run a business that doesn't make a lot of money.
Just got to get you to hang on for a second while we take a quick commercial break. We'll be right back. Sorry for the interruption, but I need your help. I'm asking you to support the show by becoming a patron. That means pledging $1 per show. Conversations is a unique program. There's no grandstanding, no arguing, no yelling. Instead, I sit down with people who have unique insights, specialized knowledge, and experiences that inform and enlighten. And we do this on an incredibly limited budget with a very small crew. Well, this is my office and it's where I edit the show. And then once it's ready, we give it away. You know, so many different websites around the world are carrying the show, but they get it for free. They don't pay us. So I'm asking you to pledge $1 per show by going to patreon.com/conversationsthatmatter. Thanks. We want to keep producing conversations, and with your help, we can. Now let's get back to the show. What does that then do for those small, independent entrepreneurs who want to operate in this commercial space? How can they function in Vancouver? And if they can't, what's the price that we pay as a city when we don't have that local kind of retail experience?
Well, in my personal experience, everything in Vancouver is more expensive than pretty much anywhere else in North America, really. You know, I travel a lot to New York and to San Francisco, and even there, things, goods and services don't cost quite as much as they do in Vancouver, and rent is absolutely part of that. So yes, we all pay more already on the very high housing costs that we face. So that's one aspect to it. But the other aspect, really, we have to admit that certain businesses are not going to operate.
Right.
And the problem with that is, yeah, sure, if it's a business just for that serves, some customers, and, those customers are going to find other options. Yeah, sure, we understand that, right? But the problem is there are some businesses, in my view, like the Railroad Club, that sort of provided more than just service to their customers, their paying customers in the store, right? They offered a venue for local artists, and it was sort of like a bit of a community building enterprise, right? And those tend not to make too much money, and those are obviously going to be the first that are going to have to shut down unless some private investor comes in and says, well, you know what, I like this business and I like this property, I'm going to subsidize it. And that's going to happen, like it has happened, but we can't count on that, right? So we're going to lose some businesses that I think as a society we perceive as valuable, but they don't make quite as much money to pay the high rents and the high property taxes.
And so what do we lose then as a society when that happens?
Well,
you talk about the fact the Railway Club was supporting local artists and so on. That's one example, but there are others. But there are others as well. So what do we wind up losing?
Well, then we become a city where every business that operates needs to make high profit margins to cover the rent. And then we're going to lose your local services, your local artist outlets, whatever the art is. Mm-hmm. You know, because those are not high margin businesses, right? I mean, they people value them a lot, but sometimes they don't pay very much for them, right? So when you're in that situation, you lose those community building stores and businesses. And that changes the city. It absolutely changes the city. It drives away the artists. It drives away the customers. You know, it's it becomes harder to provide local goods in the city.
Well, and then I think it robs us of some of our unique characteristics as well, because what winds up populating the main shopping areas are large international chains that look the same here as they do in New York, Rome, London, Paris.
Yeah.
And we're not those places. We're Vancouver. And I think for a lot of us who have called Vancouver home for a long time, we value those experiences. Yeah.
Thankfully, those international brands have become much more sensitive to the local environment. Mm-hmm. So even though it's the same chain, it doesn't look the same here as it does in New York and in London and in Shanghai, right?
Yes.
So thankfully, there's this aspect of you know, global, local business model. So things are not quite as bad as you describe them, in my view. Mm-hmm. But no question, we're losing businesses, and we're going to continue to lose businesses that contribute to our society and that we kind of like. Well, some of us like a lot. But they can't operate given those high rents.
One area that I think that is at particular risk is the standalone restaurant. Mm-hmm. You get these unique places that have been developed by a chef with a tremendous flair. For them now to be able to get into a building where they're going to have secure rent and be able to plan out over 10 or 15 years gets harder and harder. And our taste buds can really suffer.
Right. Fully agree. So the question is then, what can we possibly do about that? Right.
Well, that is the question.
And you know, obviously, we're not gonna now start subsidizing businesses to help pay the rent or provide subsidized rent or anything like that, because that will create all kinds of other issues. Mm-hmm. So, in my view, we need to increase supply. We need to increase supply both for residential through high density and through accessing new land, mm-hmm. and also for commercial. And again, how are you gonna increase supply for commercial? Well, we'll have higher density, and you know, I mean, you go to cities like Singapore and Hong Kong, and it's not one level of retail, it could be five levels of retail before you start the residential component. So this is perfectly acceptable there, and that's one avenue we can go.
So when building a high rise is going to have residential and commercial,
yeah, but you're not just street level, right? Put a few more. I'm not a city planner or an architect, really. So obviously that has to be thought through from a design point of view. Mm-hmm. But it seems to me that's a way to increase the square footage of available commercial space, given that we really have very limited land.
What do we do, though, when we've got a spot where there's been a supermarket for 30 years, mm-hmm. and they say, well, we're going to close down because our return on investment here, like a supermarket, isn't high enough because the rents are so high. Is there an argument for saying there needs to be some government intervention so that we can make sure that those essential services in neighborhoods and whatnot can remain?
Well, so I wouldn't go into subsidizing the rent or the business, mm-hmm. Because that creates all kinds of other incentives that don't end well.
Yes.
What I would like to see, however, is to say, okay, well, if you allow in your new development, if you allow space for a supermarket, which we perceive is needed in that area, that's fine. We'll give you the option of building two more floors, or we'll give you an option to, you know, do some. You know, there are ways to incentivize developers. Mm-hmm. Put offers on the table and say, look, you know, a supermarket cannot generate the rate of return that this valuable property requires. So how about we do that anyway, and then you get higher density, easier building code. I don't know. There are ways to make it worthwhile for developers to allow for that space that is designated for a supermarket or a, or a library or whatever we decide we need.
Also under threat is industrial land. And there we see with, let's say, Molson's, for instance, in Vancouver, shutting down. There's a precast concrete plant out in South Richmond that decided to sell its property rather than stay in business. Jobs are disappearing as a result. What is the potential risk if we start seeing all of this happen, that businesses are saying it's less expensive for me to sell my business than to keep operating?
Yeah, that's kind of thing is going to happen with high land values. So again, the solution in my view is to say, okay, well, you know what? We really need to have some industrial space that is now zoned industrial, right? So the way we can handle that is to put those warehouses and plants underground, you know, dig deep, build higher up, so that we retain more or less the square footage that we currently have. But it's not like those, you know, typical boxes of, industrial buildings that we're used to. It's going to go underground, most of it, and on top you're going to have residential. And again, that is being done all over the world, mixture of different property uses on the same property. And it's a matter of design to accomplish that in a way that everyone is happy. So what I guess what I'm calling for is a lot more flexibility from City Hall. And if there is a business that says, well, you know what, I'm thinking of selling my property because that generates higher rate of return, well, don't do that. How about we let you build your condo tower on top of what you already have? You know, I mean, obviously you might have to redo the building.
Right.
But we'll let you increase.
Or enter into a joint venture with a developer who will say, I'm going to
work with
you.
Sure. I don't mean for the marble place to build their own tower, right? But yes. Joint venture, retain the existing property or square footage of industrial land or whatever it is that we perceive as valuable, and then build on top so that both the current owner is happy and the business continues to operate. And there's increased supply of residential, which we badly need.
If we don't come up with some kind of plan that's going to make commercial industrial space available, how successful can we be in our drive to become this super digital center of excellence? You know, the president and CEO of Microsoft, as I understand, was in Burnaby at BCIT just recently talking about this grand future for British Columbia. But if we can't make even the office space affordable, how are we going to be able to realize that dream?
So you're absolutely correct. I think Vancouver is, and the Lower Mainland in general, is in a unique position right now to take advantage of those high-tech opportunities and really compete with Washington, Seattle mostly, and also San Francisco. And it is because, you know, of how international relations are shaping and different policies. And, you know, Vancouver is a pretty nice place. I think that's a real opportunity. So then the question is, you're absolutely right. If the cost of that industrial land or office land is too high, how are we going to handle that? Well, again, I go back to my recommendation for creative design that has different property uses on the same property and builds up and builds underground so that we have the square footage, and in fact we increase the square footage. We benefit the current owner, we benefit the developer. Seems like it's a win-win for everyone. I really don't see who would object to that.
I like your idea of flexibility, but what are the impediments to creating that flexible system? How important is it that not only are the people we elect, but those who actually work in and manage these departments have the same perspective?
Well, City Hall, in my view, Vancouver City Hall is a major impediment to development right now. The development process takes forever, years. The requirements are hugely burdensome. It puts people off, right? So then to build something, you need an extraordinary rate of return to make it worthwhile to deal with City Hall. That's my impression of how things are. So we need a much more simplified building code and much more flexible and simplified zoning, where if a current owner, especially of industrial or commercial property, wants to do something a little bit more creative, well, they should get that project reviewed and hopefully approved very, very quickly at a much lower cost than is happening right now.
So the way you say it, I totally agree. But how likely do you think that's going to happen here in the city of Vancouver?
Well, so the problem is that every time we make a change, we seem to enhance property rights, and then with the other hand, we seem to reduce them. So mm-hmm. in my view, we should never, ever, ever reduce property rights. We should never infringe on property rights. In my view, we should enhance them all the time. So there is a current proposal to allow duplexes and triplexes in single family zoning. That's fine, but give it as an option. Don't take any potential uplift with the other hand and say, oh, but now we're going to limit the unit size and that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. So my view there is don't ever force anyone to do anything, but give the flexibility and the option for the current owner to do that mixed use development and to build higher and to build more and to go deeper underground. Some developers are not going to do that. Some owners are not going to do that, but hopefully some will. Mm-hmm. And when they do, fingers crossed, those are going to be successful projects, and then more owners are going to take advantage of it. But right now, as I understand it, you can't.
Right.
So even if someone has great ideas, and I know people who do, it's really hard to get anything done in this city. So we can't even see an example of a successful large-scale mixed-use project that I'm advocating for.
So when I listen to you, I hear you say property values are going up, but the opportunity to expand the business community is somewhat stagnant.
Yes.
And we run the risk of stalling out our community. The people who live and work here can't afford to live and work here.
Exactly. And that's what we have so far with our current policies, which are very restrictive. And we shouldn't be surprised that this thing is going to continue until we change our policies.
Which handcuffs us from realizing what could be a terrific potential for
Absolutely. This city. Absolutely. We can be leading the world in many respects. At least we can be leading North America with creative design that benefits the owners. Everyone's happy and making money. And we get access to enough industrial and commercial square footage that we need to grow our economy.
Well, I want to thank you for coming in and having this conversation, because nobody's talking about this. They're only just talking about home values. But if we can't provide the space for business to operate, well, then a lot of it doesn't matter.
Right. So in my view, let people do creative solutions, untie their hands, and the market will find ways to address the problem. It always does.
And you're going in the complete opposite direction of governments at the moment.
Thank
you
very much
for coming in and doing this.
All right, absolutely. Thank you for having me. Mm-hmm.